Dear distinguished colleagues, arbitrators, counsels, professors, and all arbitration enthusiasts, I would like to welcome you today on behalf of the Graduate Law Society of the University of Cambridge to today's Young Practitioners event co-organized with Young Arbitrators Forum of the International Chamber of Commerce, also known as the ICC YAF. ICC YAF is a forum that is open to the practitioners of international arbitration that are under 40 years of age, and its objective is to create a platform where young counsels and young arbitrators can learn from more experienced professionals about career development and issues of interest in international arbitration in general. Young Practitioners event is held at the university for the fourth time this year, and it marks the unofficial beginning of the main event of the year, the Cambridge Arbitration Day, that starts tomorrow at 10 o'clock in the morning, and to which you are all warmly welcome. The theme for discussion for this afternoon is the clash between the common law and civil law cultures in international arbitration. And as you will see, our four speakers who come from both common law and civil law backgrounds, Alexi Martinez, Saadia Bhatty, Ania Farren, Ruth Byrne, and Timothy Foden, will discuss different aspects of what this cultural clash means in practice. And it is my pleasure to introduce you Ania Farren, a former student from the University of Cambridge, who is currently a partner at Berwin, Leighton, Paisner. Ania specializes in international arbitration of both commercial and investment arbitration, and she focuses on energy and natural resources sector and oil and gas. Ania, I leave the floor to you.
Thank you, Lucia, and thank you for doing such a splendid job in organising today's events, and thank you to all the other organisers in the room. Welcome. It's an unnerving experience for me sitting at the front here, because between 1996 and 1999 I used to be the student asleep in the back row. I used to row for Downing and then cycle over here in my wet rowing gear and fall asleep during the lectures. So I probably indicated to you how old I am, but this is the reason to go into arbitration. If you're doing arbitration, you get to call yourself young until you turn 40. So all of us here are still officially young. You may not believe it, but we are. So as Lucia said, this is an ICC YAF event. YAF stands for Young Arbitrators Forum. I'm the rep for the UK. Though my term ends in June, so someone will be taking over from me. Just to give you a kind of an idea of how many members we have in ICC YAF worldwide, apparently about 12,000. In the Europe and Russia chapter, about 5,000. If any of you are not already members, please go online, sign up, it's free. If you do have an interest in arbitration, which I assume all of you do, there are lots of free events you can attend in London every year. Just to get an idea of who's in the room, how many of you are students? Hands up. Okay. Students here in Cambridge? Okay. And practitioners? Okay, great. Thank you. All right, so I'm going to briefly introduce our speakers, and then another thing to mention, our events are aimed at being very interactive, so we are going to keep presentations short so that you can ask lots of questions and we can engage in a lively discussion. So please do feel free to ask even, you know, the questions you think are stupid. Put your hand up at any stage during the panel. Right, so we have four excellent speakers. We're going to start with Saadia Bhatty, and she's going to be talking about discovery and document production. Saadia Bhatty is the ideal candidate to talk about the clash between common law and civil law approaches in arbitration, because she studied in Paris, but is New York qualified. That's right, isn't it? And then we have Alexis Martinez. Sorry, I should have mentioned Saadia is an associate at Clyde & Co. in London. Then we have Alexis Martinez. He is a partner at Squire Patton Boggs. And he studied in Paris and is French qualified, but also UK qualified. And he's going to be talking about advocacy in arbitration. We have Timothy Foden at the end. He's of counsel at Quinn, Emanuel. He is Washington qualified, is that right? And he is going to be talking about the role of counsel. And then we have Ruth Byrne. She's a partner at King & Spalding. She is UK qualified, and she is going to be talking to us about the interrelationship between the courts and arbitration. So I'm going to turn to Saadia, who's going to start off.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and thanks, thanks for the invitation to come and speak. So I was saying thank you very much for the introduction, Ania, and thanks for the invitation to come and speak. I'm just going to start with a small anecdote here. I moved to New York when I was, I had practiced in Paris for 3 years, and I was brought into a case. When I started, they were like, oh, you're French, so we have a case with, civil arbitrators, French law applicable, and it's a dispute on intellectual property. So you're perfect for this. It's in French. Do you want to be involved in the case? I was like, yeah, sure, that's perfect. And they're like, okay, so can you start reviewing the documents? And I was like, fine. And so they told me, okay, you need to log on the system and start reviewing the documents. And I had never used such a software in my life. And all the other, people I was working with didn't have an experience in arbitration, but they were in litigation. They told me, well, how is it possible that you've never done this before? And I was like, well, I don't know. I mean, usually we just get like binders of document, but we don't have like this sophisticated software. We need to tag documents. And you know, when I looked into the case, I realized that this was very similar to actually US style, discovery style case. I mean, it wasn't exactly like that, but I had never seen so many documents in my life. There were so many orders of disclosure that were already made. And literally, we had to go through thousands of documents overnight, tag them, whether they were confidential, not confidential, and write pleadings about additional productions for documents. And this is the first time, I think, in my life where I noticed there was a real clash between the common law and the civil law approaches in arbitration. So, I mean, because I'm starting, I think one of the questions I asked myself to understand was, like, why is there such a difference of approach? Why is, US-style discovery so into documents, and why are the civilian a bit more reserved about this? And I think you probably already all know this, but it's good to remind it. It's like in the U.S. you have this obsession for the search for the truth, right? And it's kind of comes from the jury kind of trial system, and it's kind of divided by this when you have this pre-trial phase before the trial actually starts. And the logic behind it is everyone should have an equal access to the documents. So it really is, everyone should have the facts in hand, and then once you have all the facts out there, whether they're in your favor or not, then we're going to start to kind of make a real case. The civilian approach is completely, different in that regard. And I think, Yves Derain said it in a better way. The idea is really, how do you frame the dispute at hand? So in terms of legal issues. And once you've got the legal issues formulated, then the facts come in to kind of nourish, your case. So, and as my colleagues are going to speak afterwards, the role of the judge, of the arbitrator, is actually very different with regards to whether you come from a common law, civil law approach, in the approach for documents. So I do think that there really is a big divide between the common law and the civil law approaches in terms of discovery and document production. I think it's Finizio that called discovery the Frankenstein's monster in the digital age, and it is true that the French, at least the French, I mean, being French, but the civilian lawyers are a bit scared when they hear the word discovery. In the UK, we more talk about disclosure, and I understand it's a much limited approach than in the US. And, you know, in arbitration, it's very interesting because the procedural rules are not the only rules that define how a document disclosure is going to be decided. So there's also sometimes the substantive rules are applicable. And as we're going to discuss today, it also very much depends on the background of arbitrators, as I said, of counsel, and also the case at hand. If it's a very heavy, factual, you know, complex dispute like the one I was involved with in intellectual property, then, you know, there's a big chance that there are going to be a lot of, you know, disclosure orders or and discovery type process going on. If you're having a case like the one I was involved in, I just had a hearing finished yesterday where there were jurisdictional objection in an ICSID case, well, honestly, facts didn't really matter that much at this stage, so it was not very relevant. And I think our, you know, document production is a great example in arbitration where, I don't know if that word exists, but there's like a simon law, a mix of civil and common law approach of document production. And why is that? Well, because I think, you know, people got together and they're like, listen, we need to find, well, arbitration is supposed to be flexibility and certainty, so we need to have harmonized rules for document production to give guidelines to the parties. And this is where the IBA rules, so the International Bar Association rules, came in. You know, there were the first rules in 99, then they were revised in 2010. And there's a big emphasis on efficiency, and at the same time, you know, giving the tools for an arbitrator to make those document requests if they need to be. But the difference with the, you know, what I would say the US approach is that they have to be certain limited to you know, certain relevant documents, because the in the US the federal, you know, rules of civil procedure, you can pretty much order disclosure for any documents, whether, you know, I mean, there is a relevance requirement, but it's not as strict. And so under the IBA rules, it's much more defined. And so in that regard, a lot of, you know, commentators and people say that it is a big mix, a good mix between the common law and civil law approach. The notion of good faith is also in there. So there's a debate as to, you know, from a civil law lawyer or from a common law lawyer, what is good faith? It's not exactly the same thing as well. So that has not been considered very helpful. But there are different tools that came into place. So I don't know if you're you know, familiar with the Redfern schedule. So Alan Redfern came in with this tool of, this is a table that you need to put forward with, you know, a description of the document and the nature and, you know, how relevant it is and Thrymal's comments, etc. So this is an agreed approach in arbitration where people use this tool to move forward with document production. And as I said, you know, it very much depends also on the experience of counsel, on arbitrators, and, you know, what your training is, really. And you know, we come to a conclusion where, you know, you find that, okay, it's nice to have a mix between both approaches in common law and civil law, but you end up having a sort of a blur where you don't really know what your tribunal is going to do. So it's a bit of inefficient in that regard, where, for example, I had some cases where there were, you know, document disclosure order of documents, sorry, from the tribunal, and the other side didn't comply, and yet the tribunal didn't do anything about it. And yes, they have the power, you know, under the arbitration rules to draw adverse inferences, but if you were in court, there would be no, you know, there would be no debate that there were going to be, you know, negative, you know, adverse inference drawn, or even, you know, a pecuniary consequence out of this failure to comply with an order. That's not the case in arbitration. And I think that's the point that's interesting to debate, is whether or not we're not here in sort of a mush between common law and civil law approaches, which ends up being, you know, okay, it's a flexible approach, but it's ends up being a bit inefficient because you never know if the arbitrators, you know, what are gonna be the consequences of a failure for, you know, document disclosure, for example. So there's also this, I mean, you know, you always have to think about this due process paranoia that the arbitrators have. They have, on the one hand, to comply with, you know, this interest of everybody should have the documents that they need, you know, and for the search for the truth. But on the other hand, they're like, okay, there needs to be an equal arms of the parties, and they need to be able to respond, etc. And they're also afraid of challenges in arbitration. So, you know, if they refuse an order for document request by one party, they're afraid that, you know, at the end of the day, maybe that party will maybe challenge the tribunal. So they're pretty lenient in accepting, you know, those kind of document order for document production. I mean, that's at least my experience. But on the other hand, they don't go until the end, because if they order such a document, order for document production, and the other side doesn't comply, then why don't they use the tools then, to kind of draw the specific adverse inferences out of that? So that's a question I'm putting out there. So I don't know, I think I spoke more than 5 minutes, because that was a big wide introduction. I wasn't given more than 5 minutes, but I'm interested to hear about my colleagues on this.
Well, I'm going to turn to the panel in a second, but for those of you that have never participated in an arbitration, just kind of to give a little bit of background, usually we put our party's case in a written submission, which tends to be a fairly long document, depending on the case. But it can be 100 pages, 200 pages. I've worked on submissions that were 800 pages. And then you tend to footnote all the relevant documents and supply to the other party all of the documents that you've relied on. So you will deliver your written submission with, you know, X number of binders with all of the documents that you've relied on. And then the other party will do the same in response. So usually there are kind of limited disclosure requests after the first exchange of submissions. So it can happen at various stages during the arbitration. So then you have that opportunity to ask for documents that you're interested in seeing from the other side that haven't already been produced with the written memorial. So that's kind of just a basic explanation of how the documents come into the process. And I wonder whether there are any thoughts on what Saadia said from the panel before I open up to questions.
I'll speak shortly about how I think that largely the process has been converged such that we all operate on largely the same grounds in terms of disclosure and all other aspects of the advocacy process in international arbitration. But I'll say that you do bring up a point that I think is it really is demonstrative of people's backgrounds. So I did a case for years against the Republic of Spain, and at a certain point, the proceedings were clearly led on the other side by a lawyer of common law background, and then at some point it switched to a former state prosecutor from the government of Spain who had moved over to the law firm that was handling the defense of Spain in the case. And in that instance, we were hit with a jurisdictional objection, one of which was that as claimants, we had not established jurisdiction because we had not provided all documents upon which we rely in our very first submission. And if you come from a common law background, you know that you only supply the documents that you want to put in your first submission, the ones that make you look good. You might perhaps put in all of these sort of perfunctory documents that establish jurisdiction, but if you know that there's going to be a massive cost difficulty in doing so, you don't. So in this instance, we had to put in three Spanish documents from local municipalities throughout Spain for each one of the special project vehicles that had held an investment in solar power in Spain. That was thousands. So we would have had to submit thousands and times three of all of these sort of permissions or permits from the Spanish government. And we thought, we don't need to do that. You know, the tribunal will accept that we have established that these are actual investments until challenged. Well, the other side said that the case should be thrown out then and there upon their objection, that we had missed the chance to put these documents in. And I'll tell you that we sweated it a bit, because you always, when you start to go through the advocacy process, you always give some credit to the other side's case, particularly after you've held their submissions for a long period of time. You start thinking, oh, well, gosh, if we don't establish jurisdiction because we didn't put in 33,000 of these certificates from Andalusia, then it's my ass. I'm fired from this law firm. Well, of course, the tribunal came back and said, this is nonsense. This is an iterative process. We haven't even, you know, this is the statement of claim. You will have plenty of opportunities to go through it. And what's more, because of the objection, we put them all in. But then we got this objection from the other side, Spain, saying, well, no, you can't put them in now. You had your chance. And it was typical form over substance. But that is the approach in Spanish law. So, as a consequence, I had this really lovely task of every couple of weeks having to fly over to Madrid and sit with this partner in our Madrid office, who Alexi knows quite well, who would give me what Alex Ferguson used to call the hairdryer treatment every day, because he thought we were going to lose in this point, because he came from a Spanish background in which you put all those documents in at the beginning. And the partner had sent me over was a fellow American, and he was like, oh, don't worry about it, buddy, it's fine, it's fine. But he wasn't going to Madrid. He wasn't the one having to sit there and get yelled at by this guy with a double-barreled last name and told that, you know, that's not how we do things in Madrid. And he was, what's more, what's called a state lawyer, former state lawyer, and these are like the top of the top lawyers in Spain. And it fucking sucked, you know?
You're being recorded, yeah. You can't swear.
I don't care. So, you know, there is some convergence in that, but it's a matter of approach. The tribunal, in that instance, put that jurisdictional objection aside in an instant. It garnered more than maybe perhaps 2 to 3 paragraphs in their award. But it's reflective of the fact that when you get people who aren't kind of converged into the arbitration approach, they will come to it with their relevant background. And you see that from Americans as well. They will compound disclosure requests or discovery requests on the other side. Or sorry, propound is what is the weird legalese term of art in the US legal system. And it's, you know, thousands upon thousands of questions that are all pretty much the same thing. And the tribunal is there to tell them, that's not how we do it in this field.
So you're referring to the clash of cultures between counsel, but what if you have a mix of cultures on the tribunal itself?
In that instance, we had one of the tribunal members. We had two tribunal members who were from civil law jurisdictions, and we had one who was Charlie Brower, who is an American lawyer but has basically been in Europe since the early 1980s. And one of the arbitrators in that case was new to investment treaty arbitration. He's a former ICJ judge called Bernardo Sepulveda. And we got the distinct feeling that he was being coached on how things are done. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Kaufman Kohler wrote the award, and despite being a civil lawyer, you have got a real issue and a potential due process objection, mm-hmm. if you're not allowing another party to submit documents that they didn't put in their first submission, just because, you're giving the other side some kind of tactical benefit? It was silly, but it was something that was silly that cost the client probably £500,000. Mm-hmm.
And a lot of stress for everyone, including himself. Yeah,
my trainee, he suffered.
Okay, any other, did you want to respond?
Yeah,
to
I just, actually, it's a linked point. I just wanted to say, and I'd like to hear, you know, from my colleagues on this. Have you ever found a smoking gun?
Yes.
You have?
Yeah.
Has that happened a lot of times?
Actually, quite a few times, yeah. Okay. But actually, something that you talk about, point arising from, I mean, can you hear me in the back? Yeah.
Well, it's being recorded, Alexi, so.
Okay.
No, like, seriously, they need the mic for the
Yeah, okay, so they can't hear me. Okay, well, it's something when I was preparing for my presentation advocacy, I actually included a discovery in advocacy, because for me, in arbitration, it's something you use to get arguments against the other side. But that's also a key difference between say the UK and US courts and the French courts, then the UK and the US at the outset, you have to disclose documents relevant to your case, whether they are in your favor or they go against you. In France, you only disclose what you want to disclose. So obviously you're not going to disclose what goes against you. Now arbitration, the solution is a mix of the two. You get to request a lot of documents, But at the outset, there's no obligation to produce something that goes against you. So part of the game of document production is trying to identify and get from the other side documents that would be helpful to you, your case, and would undermine their case. And also part of the game is, if you have any, to prevent them from getting your bad documents. So I thought it was an interesting point. And I mean, if I can share some experience, in an investment treaty case, we were acting for an investor against Mexico. And the story went that way. Our client did everything right. The government did not like us, so they sent an intervener to manage the project. That intervener did a great job. The project flourished. So the intervener was fired and replaced by a new intervener who clearly had a job that was to close down the business and make us look bad. So that was our case anyway. Mexico said that was completely wrong. That's not what happened. However, when we looked at the documents they sent us during disclosure, we found a letter, an internal letter within the government, saying that, well, the current intervener has not done the job properly, and it is time to appoint a new intervener who will do the job well. And again, this is where, this sounds already quite damning, right? They want to find someone that's going to do a good job. What is a good job? Is it to get rid of us? And now, another point here, the document was translated into English with a Spanish original. And if you looked at the Spanish original, because they changed the ending of nouns, depending on whether it's feminine or masculine, you could tell that actually they wanted to name a new intervener feminine, a new woman. So that was clearly a hint that they already had picked the intervener, and they had picked her for some very, very specific reasons. So that was our smoking gun. And then that exploded the hearing, because very cleverly we put the document in front of her. And again, very cleverly, she refused to answer any question. When she got the document in front of her, we asked her, "Have you seen this document before?" And she said, "You mean this piece of paper exactly?" "No, I mean this document." "Well, yes and no." And that went on and on for about 15 minutes, and she just killed her credibility. In fact, to terminate her credibility, she finished by saying that she was born a member of the PAN party, which was the party in power. She had all her life been a member of the PAN party, and she would die a member of that political party. So, as you can imagine, that smoking gun and combined with that testimony made a great impression on the tribunal.
I found smoking guns, but it's not just about the search for the smoking gun. You know, you can find documents. I took over a case last year where we were brought in just to do the hearing. And through disclosure, the lawyers that had been working on the case found these documents in which the other side was calling our client racist names, inapplicable racist names. They kept calling him a white man, but he was from Egypt, which he took real umbrage with. But it was like, you know, these emails where they said things, they were a Malaysian company, and they were saying, "Look, I'm going to scare this guy off our tail with this email. I've put it down below. Let me know what you think. I put some," and then they kind of went into Malay, but we translated it. It was like, "I put some shrimp paste in there," which for those of you who know anything about cooking from that area, it's like really spicy. And it said, "I'm going to scare that white man a bit." And it was like, "Well, what white man? The guy's last name is, his name is Yusri McHammer." Like, he's, you know, but lo and behold, what came at the first line of our submission and our opening submissions? In large part because we didn't really have a case, but we had to trade on something.
What about you?
Not so much a smoking gun story is, and I thought it was really interesting what you said, Saadia, about this notion that, and I think it's definitely predominant in common law jurisdictions, that we have this idea that justice is still about the truth, and therefore you've got to get all the documents because then you might actually get to the truth. And I think there's a bit of naivety to us all if we really think that's what it's about. But I had the unusual experience last year where I had run a whole case in a private international commercial arbitration, English governing law, London seat, but with a quite mixed tribunal, very limited document production. And very frustratingly, having heard the whole case, the tribunal then rendered an award refusing jurisdiction. So then we re-ran the case in the English Commercial Court with full-on English disclosure. And we really thought going into that arbitration we had everything we wanted. We wanted to close down document production when it came to it, all the rest of it. We enjoyed the fact that we had this civil law tribunal that wasn't really going to go for huge amounts of disclosure. What we found in those documents was unbelievable and really educational in terms of how the same case can look utterly different, factually speaking, having run us in two very different processes. So I don't know what that's really taught me. I suppose not to make assumptions at the beginning of a case as to whether or not you have everything. There could be more out there.
So to ask for more, maybe?
more. Yeah, probably. And maybe not be so cocksure that you want to nominate a civil law lawyer if you think there might be some out there.
Are there any questions, comments from the floor? Come on, someone must have a burning question. No. What about the technology involved in all of this? Because you're the next generation. So, when I started out, a lot of the time documents were being delivered to counsel and to tribunal members as hard copy binders. You know, I've been involved in cases where you'd be packing 20 boxes of binders per party and per tribunal member, and as a junior lawyer it's a lot of work. I stayed up a lot of nights page checking binders, but now obviously times have changed, so not always, but a lot of the time those hard copy binders are replaced with electronic exchanges.
That's the case in the common law jurisdictions, but I work a lot with our Paris office.
Yeah.
And they're like, what do you mean we need a document reviewing software?
So they're still on the...
No, that's not how we do it. Come on.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, also, there's a real... I think, Saadia covered it quite well. There's a very kind of laissez-faire approach to disclosure. And, we can ask the client if they have those documents. But if they say no, well, there's really nothing we can do about it. That's not the approach you take in the common law jurisdictions, because... you most likely did your training in circumstances in which you're appearing for a court that has coercive powers over you. People can get sanctioned. People in the U.S. can lose their law licenses. Your client can lose their case because of a disclosure failure. And digital forensics allow you to figure out now if something important should have been disclosed but wasn't. But where arbitration is being conducted out of a Parisian office might be a bit different approach. That said, we can come to this later, you tend to get found out about it when it comes time for the hearing.
Mm-hmm. And if I may, it also very much depends on the arbitrator, right? I mean, if you're dealing with old arbitrators, which are the majority of arbitrators in the world today,
About 40.
No, I think they're above 60, to be honest. So there's a middle ground of those people. They like paper a lot. And, we could have a discussion on environment and arbitration as well. But, seriously, those bundles, the arbitrators, in all the cases I work with, they always ask for the bundles. And I think that was helpful in one of our cases where there were so many documents at issue, and we had just, printed out a huge, and it took the entire wall on our side at the ICC, and we just wanted to show the tribunal how many documents that involved, and I think there's a power to that as well. If you show, stacks of documents, of files and folders, of how many documents this involved, as opposed to, we've got it on this USB key or something, which you can't really see.
I actually think at the moment we've got the worst of all worlds, because in the most recent case I was working on, we actually sent an email to the tribunal saying, how would you like your documents delivered? You can have them in hard copy. We can download them, all of them, onto an extranet site, and you'll have 48 hours to kind of access them and upload them on your computers. Or we can send out USB sticks. And the chairman helpfully responded, we'd like all three. Really? That was not the intention when I sent out the email. So, anyway, any comments? Yeah, one in the back. Can you introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name is Tatiana.
Hi, Tessia.
I'm from Decker in DC. And I have a question about how you deal with issues of privilege, or arguing that a document is privileged, particularly if you do have a tribunal from a mixed background or a lawyer from both sides from different backgrounds.
Is there anyone on the panel?
Yeah, I'll do that. I'll take that one. I mean, in my experience, in a way, arbitration practice has defined its own notion of privilege that's neither the one you'd find... I mean, in here, it's very hard to talk about common law and civil law. That's not the one you have in the UK, not the one you have in Switzerland, not the one you have in France, not the one you have in the United States, not the one you have in Italy, in Germany, Spain, wherever. And it tends to be very cautious. So you can argue both privilege and confidentiality. So I've rejected applications for documents because a lawyer was copied in an email, therefore a lawyer was somewhat involved, therefore that was enough to invoke privilege. Also, normally I've had successfully fought back applications for documents on the ground that there was some sort of commercial sensitivity, and if the other side were allowed to access those documents, then they would find out too much about the company, and since they were competing in certain sectors, they should not have access to that. In some cases, that doesn't work. They say, in that case, just do a data room, leave the documents there, but let some people see them and then leave. I mean, privilege and arbitration, to sum up, is a very fluid and generally very, and confidentiality. It's not really privilege, I'm quite more confidentiality. It's a very fluid and very broad notion, and it's guided, generally, in my view, by tribunals wanting to be cautious and avoid any cost to let something out of the bag that could potentially be seen as confidential or privileged.
And again, if I may, I think the issue of remedy here is one that is very interesting in arbitration. I mean, we had a case where the other side disclosed, we had another case with them, and there was an award and we agreed it was going to be confidential and all the proceedings were confidential, but that proceedings had stopped. And it was a very similar case to another one that we had at the same party, and they disclosed the award. They said, oh, look, tribunal, look at the other tribunal, and this is what they thought about. There was a notion of force majeure involving a certain state, and this is what they thought. So this, and we were like, wait, this is completely confidential. You breached the confidential agreement. And they're like, okay, what's the remedy? How do you do that? And the tribunal had it. So what are they going to do? Are they just going to ignore it, or? And usually at the beginning of the proceedings, the tribunal is like, we've got the documents, it's relevant for a determination, we're going to, bring it in. And we can fight for it, but then it's a fight before which jurisdiction? That's the question, right? I mean, we agreed to confidentiality in the terms of reference at the beginning of the arbitration proceedings. Their proceedings were finished. So is it something that we're going to bring, before the course of the seat of arbitration that finished, or in the current arbitration? I mean, it's not the same. So these are very complicated questions, and often the remedy is an issue in arbitration, I would say, in my experience at least.
I mean, I think privilege is a really interesting question and kind of demonstrates, how complex certain issues can be in arbitration. And it could lead to a very complex kind of conflict of law analysis. I had to think about how many different laws might apply to the question of privilege, and I think I came to about 10. I mean, if you think about all the laws that come into play, where the document was produced, where it was exchanged, where each of the counsel resides, where each of the parties resides, what is the seat of the arbitration, what is the substantive law, and so on. So there are lots of potential laws that might apply, and often actually a tribunal will want to avoid that very complex analysis. And so there are provisions in the IBA rules of evidence that can guide a tribunal through the question, but often the tribunal will apply kind of the broader standard, so there's kind of an equality between the parties, so that there isn't a narrower standard applying to one counsel than there is to the other, for example.
Are you licensed in DC? Then you're bound by the DC ethical rules.
Yep.
And I know the bar counsel there, Gene Shipp, he would love to hear this conversation. He would find it so amusing, because anyone that doesn't go into one of these situations bringing into it their own ethical requirements is likely to get brought up on it. And I think that international arbitration is very fertile ground for bar counsel in various jurisdictions to get involved, because there's a certain level of flexibility that everyone seems to think is okay that would be if you were doing it in the U.S. courts.
Yeah.
And it's a conversation I used to have with your boss, Arif Ali, all the time back at a former firm about, no, we've got to turn this over.
Yeah, and also, I mean, that it also demonstrates the difference between common law and civil law approaches, right? Because in civil law countries, they don't have the concept of privilege. It's secrecy or something like that, isn't it?
Well,
which attaches to the lawyer.
Two different approaches.
Right.
Privilege in common law tends... Yeah. So in common law, you look at what the purpose of the document was, what type of document it is, and that's how you define if it's privilege or not. In civil systems, you tend, and again, it's very hard to generalize because the UK system is very different from the US system, the French system is very different from the Italian system. But anyway, if you're generalizing, and in civil law, you look at who sent the document or who got the document. So it's not about the content of the document, it's about who sent it or who got it. That's all that matters. So for example, two French lawyers discuss what happened during the football match for some reason in the course of a case, that's privileged. Because it's two lawyers.
Okay. Did you have
anything else? Okay. I was engaged in a heated application and exchanges on whether or not an expert was allowed to get their handwritten notes outside, out of a data room, because they we said they couldn't take... they were confidential, and they said, no, 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 the rule says we are allowed to take our handwritten notes out. And Tim is very familiar with who was on the other side. And their argument was, well, they say it's handwritten notes, but what they've done really is they've copied over 12 pages, line by line and word by word, what was written in a document. So those are not notes, it's a copy of a document by their name. Anyway, so we won that one pretty easily, but we still had to spend about a month arguing back and forth, and it cost a lot of money, but there you are.
Okay, so any other questions? One back.
Abhinash Bari, I'm an independent practitioner from India. So there was this one arbitration I was involved in which we had actually disclosed the email to the other party. But somehow the other party had procured one of the laptops of the employees, and they didn't disclose it, and we fought it, and then we got the laptop. There was one trail mail which was given by the advocate who was advising us, the senior counsel. And they disclosed that email in the arbitration. And they used it in the advocacy. How would you say one should counter it? Because we objected it to the tribunal, but it went on. Anyway.
Sounds like you're screwed. That is one of the conundrums of our field, and I think it's really difficult when you talk to clients about confidentiality and these sorts of things, because you do get some bold tribunals that will say, sorry, we're not going to accept this, and we will treat it like it's like unread, and they will kind of obsequiously go out of their way in a final award to denote that that evidence didn't have anything to do with it. But there's a million cliches you can use for putting a cat back in a bag, and you can. And the same is true of documents that may be used in a legal proceeding, right? So almost every jurisdiction and the ICC rules themselves have this carve out in terms of confidentiality that allows you to pursue a legal right with the documents that are disclosed or submitted, even submissions in an arbitration. And when you are up against unscrupulous parties, perhaps from a jurisdiction like Russia, that might want to start some kind of criminal proceeding in Russia, you just have to sit around and deal with it. Because unfortunately, you can't say, well, everyone knows what you're really doing here. You have to treat this foreign proceeding as if it's on the same footing as the one that you're in. And it's quite unfortunate. One of the things I know someone on this panel knows quite well does is he will go after people in using their bar counsel, finding out whether they are a member of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, and, you know, having a go at them. And I think That's a bold, bold thing to do, and I hope to see more of it, frankly. Yeah. So, you know, maybe go talk to the folks in about the senior counsel who did this.
Okay, so, one more question?
I'm Yashna, I'm a student from India. I was wondering, how do blocking statutes impact discovery and disclosure of documents in arbitration?
What do you mean a blocking statute?
So, I read that some countries have statutes which prohibit or penalize people from their country for disclosing documents or things from their country in international disputes such as arbitration.
Data protection.
Mm-hmm. And it's mostly found in civil law countries, but I think Canada also has a statute for that, to that effect. Because then if the seat of the arbitration is, say, France, then that would, of course, impact the manner in which the disclosure requirement would be given the order.
Well, if you're bound, if you're counsel from that jurisdiction and you're bound by that those kinds of laws, then those are objections that you would make if you were asked to disclose those documents. Has anyone on the panel had experience of that particular question? And then it would be for the tribunal to decide whether or not to admit the documents. Yeah.
I suppose what you'd then have to, if you really wanted the documents and that objection was raised and the tribunal rejected production of the documents, you could go to either the court wherever the legislation exists, or sorry, I'm not sure if I'm actually going into the microphone properly.
Yeah, because Ruth's going to be talking about the interaction of the courts and the tribunal, so you can
Never touch them over later on.
Okay, so let's move on to Alexei's topic of advocacy.
Okay, it works. So, topic of advocacy. So, the way I approach this subject is I was interested in seeing how arbitration developed and how it was impacted by various legal systems. So, what I'm going to do is go through the solution in three systems, the UK and the US, so two common law systems, and France, a civil law system, and then see how that is reflected or not reflected in arbitration practice. So my first topic was actually discovery, but that's been covered. So I moved to written advocacy, written submissions. Now actually, I didn't really know much about the US, but I was surprised to learn when I prepared for this talk that in the US courts, it's actually unusual to have written submissions in advance. I don't need the PowerPoint. I'll make it shorter that way, and then hopefully stay within my 5-minute limit. So in the US courts, it's unusual to have written submissions. They may happen if the court asks the parties to summarize a specific point. They may occur if, as part of a strategy, you ask for a summary judgment or make a specific application. But generalizing, they actually are quite rare. In the UK, it's very different. You always have written submissions. You have pleadings to start with, in other words, a statement of case, followed by a defense. But those two documents generally are just to set out your case. You don't get into the details of the law. You're not supposed to discuss the evidence. It's just to give the judge a general overview of your case. And then, just before the hearing, you exchange skeleton arguments, which are sent to the judge, and those do discuss the law and the evidence. But then you go straight to the hearing. And skeleton arguments are very much what they're called, skeleton arguments. They're really an outline of the submissions you're going to make to the court. So that's for the two common law countries I've picked. France has a very different system. And in France, the written submissions are the most important part of your advocacy. You send all your case in writing. It has to be very detailed. You discuss the law, you discuss the facts, you enclose evidence, you enclose whatever you want to put in support of your submissions. You have several exchanges. In fact, in theory, there's no limit to the number of submissions you can have with the other side, even though, of course, the judge can say it's enough and the four is sufficient. But the time to make an impact on the judge is when you are writing your submissions. This is the key part of advocacy in the French courts. And what do you do in arbitration? Well, arbitration for written submissions has very much taken the civil law approach. You generally have six exchanges of pleadings, written pleadings, which discuss the law, which discuss the facts, which often happen expert reports, witness evidence, etc. You start with a request for arbitration, you follow up with an answer to that request for arbitration, you then have a statement of claim, then you have a statement of defense, then you have a reply, and then you have a rejoinder. And all of those come with all the law, the facts, the evidence, all you want to put in dispute. And that's very much also where you make your arguments, and a very key point of the advocacy. So for that part, you can clearly see an impact of the civil law. Now, if you turn to witnesses, now in the US, you don't normally get a written statement of a witness before they go to court. But what does happen is they are cross-examined very thoroughly, and they can be prepared for cross-examination also very thoroughly by the advocates. In England and Wales, stop saying the UK. In England and Wales, you have a written witness statement beforehand. Then you have cross-examination in the court. And there's a very limited amount of preparation you can do for your witness. In theory, you're not allowed to do very much. And in practice, very little actually gets done. In France, witnesses are actually very rare outside of criminal proceedings. The general approach of the courts, and that's very much true throughout civil law countries, is that witnesses are not reliable, and it's better to have hard written evidence, and that will trump every single time, at least in the mind of the advocates, anything a witness can say. So witnesses are quite rare, but if they do appear, there's a witness statement, and then there's an interrogation at the hearing by both the judge and the advocates. Now, what's the solution in arbitration? Well, the solution in arbitration is actually almost identical to the English approach. You have a written statement that is submitted with the written submissions in advance, and that is then followed by cross-examination at the hearing. In fact, hearings are usually centered on the cross-examination of witnesses and experts. So there we go. So now we see arbitration being impacted by yet another system. Thirdly, I'm going to talk about the actual oral arguments at the hearing, the oral advocacy at the hearing. In the US and in the UK, here, they are quite similar. This is your chance to make an impact. This is where you discuss the law. This is where you discuss the facts. This is where you discuss the evidence with the judge. And this is pretty key. It can last a long time, particularly in the UK. You can have hearings lasting over a month, where you discuss every single point of fact and law and try to convince the judge. In France, it's much shorter, and the hearing is just seen as an opportunity to highlight the key points of your case, and for the judge to ask any question they may have that arose in the written submissions. So this here is a very big difference between civil and common, at least France and the UK and the US. And what did arbitration go for? Well, here, arbitration has gone for a blend, although perhaps I would argue slightly more towards a civil law approach. What often happens is you have an opening submission, which is quite short, where the advocates highlight the key points of their argumentation. But that's quite short, and it's really just to highlight the key points. And for the tribunal, perhaps, although they often stay mum, to ask any questions they may have. And then, after all the witnesses have been cross-examined, you usually, but not always, have closing submissions. And these are used by the advocates to highlight the most important things that were said by the witnesses during the hearing, and they try to relate those things to their important points that they made during the opening. So that's quite an interesting system, actually, very much a hybrid of the common law and the civil law approach, although clearly much more focused on the, much more impacted by the civil law at that point. So I'll briefly conclude, really. You see in document production, you see a truly hybrid system. In terms of written submission, you see something that gives a lot of importance to the written submission and therefore is more civil law in this aspect. In terms of witness interrogation, you have something that gives it a lot of importance against unlike civil law systems and therefore shows a clear impact of common law. And in terms of the advocate's oral submission at the hearing on law and facts, again, you go back to civil law and clearly a civil law system. So something's quite interesting, really. We've seen that arbitration has developed into its own creature, which is really a blend of common and civil law approaches. Quite happy to discuss.
Are there any questions at this stage? Yep. Hi.
I come to the University of Geneva. I was wondering whether arbitration has really borrowed the best practices, in this case, from both systems.
Well, what is the best? I can give you my opinion. I think arbitration has borrowed the safest practices from all systems. So in civil law systems, there's a lot of emphasis on written advocacy. So you have written advocacy in arbitration. It's very important. Common law, there's a lot of importance given to the witnesses and the cross-examination of witnesses. Therefore, in arbitration, you have a lot of importance given to cross-examination of witnesses. And then when it comes to advocacy, that's perhaps where arbitration has taken a slightly riskier route. They've gone for the shorter, highlight the key points of the argument and give the judges or the arbitrators a chance to ask questions route. But overall, in my view, of course it's the best. But I think in summary, they've gone for the safest approach possible.
If I may just add to that, I think it's difficult to answer if it's a best practice or not, because it really much depends on a case-by-case basis. Most of the time, actually, the parties agree in advance, you know, how many, you know, exchanges they're going to be having, you know, the amount of evidence put forward, are there going to be any witnesses, no witnesses, you know, how many hearings, are there going to be bifurcation of hearings or not, you know, can you do direct examination? Or is it just going to be cross-examination? Things like that are usually discussed in advance. Are they going to be closing submissions, written submissions after the hearing? Or is the tribunal satisfied with, you know, just the oral closing submissions? So this kind of depends, of course, on the case, right? But also on the background of, you know, the tribunal and counsel, I would say. For example, if you're having an arbitration in London sometimes, you know, it's very, very different to an international arbitration that you would do in Paris, for example, because you have members of the tribunal are, you know, ex-judges who used to sit on the bench. You know, the both counsel are from, you know, are QC barristers, CPR rules are applicable. So in that, you know, in an arbitration like that, how can you compare that to, you know, another arbitration in Paris where not, it wouldn't necessarily be more civil law applicable, but it would be more a blend, I would say, of, you know, civil and common law than an arbitration that would be purely maybe, you know, orchestrated by common lawyers, maybe.
Anything to add to it? Any other questions? Yep.
Do you think it's possible to overwhelm a tribunal? I'm just thinking from a practical matter, we're talking yes. about hundreds of pages of submissions and yes. hours and hours of hearings and then all the documents you produce.
Yep.
Like, from an advocacy standpoint, is it better sometimes
Yeah, I mean, I will answer that question because I was involved in the UCOS arbitration. So for those of you that don't know, that's like the highest value arbitration of all time. I was actually on the Russian Federation side, I left before the award came out in the ECT case. So when I found out that a 50 billion award had come out against the Russian Federation, I emailed and. A fellow ex-colleague and said, great, we are now responsible for the greatest loss of all time. Thankfully, since then, the award has been challenged. But the submissions in those cases, there are several related arbitrations, were about 800-900 pages with thousands of footnotes and thousands of documents. And I mean, the tribunals referred to the fact that they found this unhelpful. And actually, it was almost embarrassing working on the case because you realised that no one was ever going to read the thousands of footnotes. Mm. And at that time, our hands were kind of tied because we were co-counselling with another law firm. So there was disagreement as to kind of what length of submissions we were going to provide and so on. And then there's this fear by most of us when we're representing a party that we're going to miss something important. So there's kind of taking the cautious approach just to put everything in, just in case we miss out something important. But I agree with you. I think that we as counsel should be much more disciplined and produce shorter submissions to help the process. To help the tribunal and make it more efficient, but that it'll depend on obviously the case.
Can I share an anecdote on that point? Actually, I mean, I agree. I mean, actually, it's to confirm what Ania has said. We were a few years ago asked to do the return arbitration in a case where our client had sacked their previous counsel because they lost billions in the previous case, and actually. Well, bankrupted the company. Literally, the company had to settle the case by giving a large amount of its shares to the winning party. So they were not happy with that counsel, which is probably the most famous arbitration firm I know of. And they came to us. But so when that happened, we're like, why did they lose? What happened? So we looked at what had happened in the past. So that very, very well-known firm, highly respected and very talented, had written very detailed and excellent submissions. But they were humongous, there were thousands of footnotes, they were extremely complicated and they're very hard to understand. And the arbitration was about the price of gas. Very complex topic, very, very hard. I mean, it's incredibly complex. The other side had produced fairly muddled but very short submissions, the side that won, but they kept repeating every page or so. The price of oil is the element that directs the price of gas. And they repeated that at least almost everywhere. And at the end of the day, the tribunal said, well, it's the price of oil directs the price of gas. Therefore, the other side wins. And they won on absolutely everything. Uh-huh. Absolutely everything. And in fact, actually, that's the reason they won, one of the reasons, in my view, it's just my opinion, why they won on absolutely everything. And I'm afraid I can't give you any more details on the case, so it's all very confidential. But the firm that lost had not articulated any backup position. So once they had lost on the main point, there was no backup to fall onto for the tribunal to decide to split the baby. So the only data they had was the one that had been provided by the winning party. So they gave the winning party absolutely everything. And that had dire consequences.
If I may just follow this excellent point that Alexi made. I actually had the opportunity to sit as secretariat for tribunals also, and that has taught me so much more than acting as counsel, actually, because you're on the other side. And you actually, you know, I mean, secretaries are not, you know, I didn't draft the award or anything like that, but you still do help, you know, very much in the construction of the award for the tribunal. They're going to make a decision. And frankly, what happens is you take both of the pleadings, and as Alexi said, you take the less complicated one to create your structure, right? So you can, I'm not saying that, you know, you copy-paste elements directly, but your students, you know, a lot of you are students here, so when you start writing a piece,
I've seen awards that look a lot like my submission.
Yeah. Well, when you start writing a structure, it kind of defines the way you're going to go in your thinking, right? So it really has a huge impact. You know, the clearer your written proceedings are, the sharper they are, they're on point, the tribunal is going to love that. The longer they are, the more complex they are. Often they always ask for, I mean, in my experience, they ask for a last, like, you know, post-hearing submission, and where the tribunal asks for 5-6 questions, and they're like, okay, it's going to be limited to 30 pages, and this is the last set of writings that you are going to produce. And what happens is that they only look at these last pleadings, you know, sometimes, at the moment of drafting the award. And it's so frustrating. You spend so many years advocating stuff, you're putting so much evidence forward, and look at the ICC awards that, you know, ICC or any other awards that are public. I mean, do they go in so much detail, honestly, a review of the evidence? Sometimes it makes me wonder, have they looked at all the evidence before you? So yeah, it is overwhelming. My response is absolutely, so you should be careful with that.
Well, I mean, the tribunal are obviously human, so you've got to, when you're writing submissions or presenting in front of them, you've just got to bear that in mind. There's only so much information they can absorb. Any other question? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Sean Mookie, but I recently qualified, and I was at Sheed, where you were, Saadia, and I did my international arbitration seat in Paris, so they have a different way of working, and they do like a lot of paper and so on, and I supported, I worked both as counsel, assisted both as counsel and assisting the arbitrator, an arbitrator at the time, and I wonder, I almost worked as a secretary, effectively, that tribunal, because I was the one who read everything and worked through everything for quite a long period of time. And so I wonder, when I used to sort of sit there and listen to the parties argue on the conference call, and they'd say, you know, we need a chess clock, or we need, we don't want closing submissions, or we want closing submissions, or we want post-hearing briefs. What would you say is probably the best way to go in terms of whether or not you should have a closing statement, or whether or not you should just simply leave it out of the equation and push for a post-hearing brief? And because I think you touched on it, and my question, I guess, is I'm wondering, is it best to sort of leave a lasting impression in a separate document that they'll look at and sort of almost just push everything else to the side because it's brought them so much turmoil for the last few weeks or months? And is it best to just go with a post-hearing brief?
Again, I mean, I probably not going to like the answer, but it's very relative, right? It really depends on your case. I mean, I just had a hearing yesterday, and I felt like the hearings went pretty well for us. So I don't want to close like a written submission, right? I'd rather the tribunal looks at the transcript as the last stuff, and we did well, and the other side didn't. And if they're given an opportunity to write, you know, submissions again, maybe they'll make another point that's stronger that didn't come out at the hearing, you know what I mean? So it really depends where you stand in your case. I mean, that's my view.
You know, personally, there's this thing that you feel at the end of a hearing where you kind of want to die, all the adrenaline leaves your body, so yes. The notion of then writing 100 pages at that stage on everything that's happened is just horrendous. Yes. But, you know, I think it's very much dictated by the quality of the advocates opposite you. If you have had oral advocates opposite you, and hopefully you don't have this happen to you often, who you feel have done incredibly well and possibly better than you, then maybe you do want a written submission to shore up your position. A lot of the time you think you've done better than them, and actually you want to leave it as is. A hybrid we've often gone for is take a month and then come back with the tribunal on a day and do an oral closing.
Well, interesting.
We've done that before. I mean, because the other thing is, I mean, it is very painful having to write a post-hearing brief because you're basically repeating everything that's happened. But it's also pretty painful preparing for a closing argument if you've been in hearings for a week or two because you probably haven't slept in days. And then you've got to, like, stay up on the last night or whatever to prepare the closings. Sometimes it's good to have a day off. Sometimes you can ask for maybe if there's time to have a day off after the close of the proceedings and before the closings. So you just have that one day to prepare for the oral closing. Or as Ruth said, you can ask. It depends where the hearing is. If it's very far away, probably people won't want to convene again in a month's time. But, you know, to have that time to go away, think about it, and then come back and do an oral closing. So there are lots of different options. Anyone else? Any other questions?
I wanted to ask, maybe on the other scale of the complexity of the voluminous proceedings, are expedited proceedings. Mm-hmm. So how do you think the procedure changes and the advocacy changes in expedited proceedings? Is it more civil law approach then, because it's mostly written, or is it a different system?
I've had one emergency arbitration and then the ICC rules. Well, actually, that's somewhere where the civil law, I mean, as far as I'm aware, like it's the UK courts, I can speak about the UK, the English courts and the French courts are nearly identical. You have a very short amount of time to produce a written application, and then almost immediately you have to argue it in person before the judge. And the judge will ask you questions whether you're in England or whether you're in France. And actually, the ICC emergency arbitration is very similar. You've got, how many days did we have? I think we had 4 days for four rounds of pleadings, basically 24 hours between each submission, followed by a hearing the next day, that was half a day. And then we had the award 2 days later, the interim award. I think what I learned there is that actually the choice of the arbitrator is extremely important. We had an issue because our client was an extremely large multinational, and the other side was another extremely large multinational. So basically, every single emergency arbitrator was potentially available was somehow conflicted. So the ICC, apparently they told us later, contacted 18 different lawyers before they managed to find one who had no conflict. And again, that goes back to the key between the common law and civil law. The law applicable for that application was Swiss law. And our arbitrator was an English judge who had just retired from the English courts. And we had a slight issue, which was that the remedy we were seeking and which was perfectly available in Switzerland, was not available in the UK. So we had to decide whether we were going to challenge that arbitrator, and then it would take a lot more time to get someone, and we may not get someone we like more, or we would just have to go for it. And so we went for it, but we were a bit disappointed by the decision because we found out that Swiss law looked a lot like English law when it was written by an English judge. So that's my experience with emergency arbitration.
I think it's fallacious to think that an expedited procedure will result in shorter briefs and more succinct statements of case. There's some old, I think, Benjamin Franklin quote about takes a very long time to write a short letter, and that's certainly the case in emergency proceedings because you just have this tendency to throw it all in there and hope that they can discern something in that more voluminous pleading that works. But, in contradistinction, work expands to fill the time either. What's required is discipline on the part of counsel and the tribunal. And I have a dear friend named Klaus Reichert who sits on a lot of tribunals, and he is been putting in page limits. And coming from the American milieu, where the most voluminous submission you can do in say the summary judgment stage is really 60 pages, I don't see any problem with that. Now, granted, I like a decent 100-page memorial that has really good pacing and sets out the cast of characters and a nice factual story before getting into the legal bit, but the 800-page submission that Ania referred to, I saw it recently in a case submitted by Brendan Pratt in Paris, an 800-page submission.
Whoa.
That's ridiculous. That's longer than Tolstoy's War and Peace. Well, almost. I think it's like 200 pages shy. Why? What could you possibly say in that amount of space that would be effective advocacy? The first thing I did when I was a student, and I would get a reading assignment, was flip to the back and say, how long do I have to go? Because we only have so much time. I'm not sitting there thinking, ooh, I've got this submission in, I've got a nice fire, glass of whiskey, all night to go through this thing. No, it's nonsense. What do you need to say in 800 pages? It's ridiculous.
I think it's very interesting that you mentioned UCOS, Ania, as well, because I don't know if you're aware, but there's a very interesting challenge that was made to the secretariat. The fact that there was actually, in essence, four members of the tribunal in the sense of three, right? Because I think the secretariat billed so much hours, so many hours. But I understand why. There were so many documents completed. But that,
over 10 years.
In what, sorry?
Over 10 years.
Over 10 years, yeah.
That's an important point to put in context.
Yeah.
10 years. $3 million in 10 years.
Yeah.
We can build $3 million in 6 months.
Right, that's true. That's true. That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
You work
it. No, I just think that Martin gets a really hard time. It's 10 years.
Yeah, no, I mean,
the challenge didn't succeed.
No, no, I know. I'm not saying that, you know, it was a good challenge or a bad challenge or anything. I'm just saying that it is true that, you know, we were talking about human beings earlier, and it's just the tribunal are human beings. And even if you have aid from a secretary or anything, there's no way someone's going to be reading your 800 pages in detail, thoroughly, and, you know, I don't think it's a great approach.
Okay, any other questions? Right, we're going to move on to role of counsel.
Ruth. Okay. So, the role of counsel, I've basically mapped out already most of my thoughts on the role of counsel. I'm asked to talk about the different approaches, different roles of counsel between the civil and common law jurisdictions as it goes to international arbitration. And my short answer, if you all want to get to the pub for St. Paddy's Day, is there is none. I could put the mic down now. I don't think there is any. Now, we've discussed earlier the important kind of backgrounds that people take into, say, disclosure, but if you're doing your job properly, my thesis is it doesn't matter what your jurisdiction is. You will approach international arbitration seeking to get every possible advantage for your client. And as a consequence, we've seen the dispute resolution system converge. And I would actually say, I would disagree with what Alexi was saying earlier, that you see more of a civil law approach in certain aspects. I think it is basically representative of an American-English hybrid approach to disputes. And I don't say that with any pride as an American. I think that's the way it is. Aside from the fact that the first time I worked on a memorial, I looked at 200 pages and thought, WTF, why is it so long? Why does it have so many footnotes? That was anathema to my background as an American lawyer. Everything else about the process is incredibly Americanized. And this is controversial, but I'm telling you, it is the way it is. The Redfern schedule is a tabular way of propounding disclosure requests. Nothing more. You read columns instead of reading paragraphs. If you do cross-examination with a civil law approach in mind, well, you should probably be fired by your client because there is no civil law approach to cross-examination. There's only a common law approach to it. And of course, there are various different approaches to doing cross-examination across the UK, Australia, New Zealand, and other common law jurisdictions. But an effective cross is an effective cross. And if you don't have any background for a cross-examination as a civil law lawyer, well, you're not doing your client's the job your client needs. I have to go teach on Monday at Sciences Po University in Paris on cross-examination. And I'm looking forward to it, because otherwise these folks, there's no training for them on this. But they need to learn how to do it. And over the past few years, I've had the pleasure of working with two people that I think are very, very good at cross-examination. One's a guy named Philippe Pinsel in Paris, and another guy is named Stephen Yagish in London. And they have pretty different approaches to the way they do it. Philippe, as a Frenchman, is incredibly good at cross-examination. So much so that last year they put out a book through GAR on the guide to advocacy, and they wrote back-to-back chapters on the approach to advocacy as a civil law lawyer and the approach to advocacy as a common law lawyer. That's largely focused on cross-examination. There is no difference between those chapters. If you ever get the book, I'll spare you the time. Read the second one. Because there's literally no... you know, I worked with Alexi for 2 years. Aside from a marked difference in quality between the two of us, there was no difference between the way that we approached doing these cases. And why is that? It's because we're doing international arbitration. It is a melange. It is a blend of both. We've already discussed disclosure. Obviously, people will take different attitudes towards it. But like I said, when you get to a hearing stage and a document comes out, say one document that you've produced that you somehow or another got a handle on, but it is clearly of a email conversation. It might not be in the chain, but logically speaking, you've got something on the 5th of April, and then you've got something on the 7th of April, and it seems like there's been a conversation that's gone on in between those two dates, but lo and behold, the other side hasn't submitted or disclosed the emails that go on to that. Well, you know what's happened there. Someone has taken some sort of different approach to jurisdiction. And what do you do then? Well, you get really American and you hammer them on it. Where is this? How come we haven't seen it? And sure enough, the tribunal, they're not dumb. They will want to see it too. For all they know, the entire case could hinge on it. So they're sitting there saying, well, yeah, it would be really good to see that document. And the other side is going to get asked for it. And then they have a choice. The choice is, okay, we submit this now with our tail between our legs, or we, I don't know, try to make up some excuse for why we didn't put it out forward, or we say it doesn't exist, and then you have the possibility of getting hit with an adverse inference. And so I think that different approach to disclosure is just one approach is good and one is bad. It's that simple. You have to do what is best for your client, and in a system that has, whether it be fortunate or unfortunate, sort of diverged over the past 15 to 20 years, you have to be the best advocate that you can be. And I can tell you right now that you're not going to be your best advocate by saying, like, oh, I wouldn't ask that question on cross-examination. Why? If you're going to get a good admission out of them and you can do it in a way that isn't rude or, you know,
well, you can do it in a rude way too.
You can do that, but then you that's one thing where there's a bit of a sensitivity. You know, you can, there's an old adage as an American trial lawyer that when the law is on your side, you bang on the law. And when the facts are on your side, you bang on the facts. And when neither's on your side, you bang on the table. And I can tell you that, you know, that approach does not fly when you've got some staunch old civil law lawyers. They will find it really uncouth. You know, these are the same people, mind you, that wouldn't turn over documents that they thought were responsive during the disclosure process. But please, by no means, be rude or obstreperous with a witness, because that's just bad tact. But that's what I have to say. I don't think that there is really a difference. I think we've all kind of merged together, and I, you know, challenge people to say otherwise, because I think we can always find that there's perhaps a decent argument to the contrary in certain senses. So, what, that's different. Well, okay, but is there a procedural advantage to be gained from doing it the other way?
Any comments on the panel?
I agree somewhat with what you say. I do think that we all merge together to a certain approach, but in terms of style of advocacy, I've really seen huge differences. Differences because counsel were trained in certain jurisdictions, so you know, when I was a G, people did their own advocacy there, even though they were civil trained, but they were from a certain generation. Also where things were done in a certain way, and even though, you know, the tribunals were international, they kept, you know, their kind of French way of doing things, but it was, you know, I thought it was pretty effective the way they were doing it. In the US, I was working with an ex-prosecutor, so you can imagine the style, and it was, you know, very prosecutor style. And there were a lot of hearings where I was with him where the tribunal was like, what are you doing? You know, like, calm down. This is not how you treat an expert witness. This is not how you treat a factual witness. And it annoyed them, you know, because they thought it was a bit, you know. And that was, and in London, so that was a complete surprise for me. I just didn't know. There's this, you know, historical difference between, you know, solicitors and barristers, et cetera. So, you know, the traditional firms in London, the law firms, they work with counsel, that meaning they have barristers in their team to argue the case. So that means something. That means that, you know, they think they can't do it and they need a professional advocate to advocate their case, which is completely, from, you know, at least someone who has practiced in Paris, completely ludicrous. Why would you not be able to advocate your case when you've seen the facts and everything you worked it for so many years, and that is the London approach. And I think,
well, it's fair to say not necessarily the London. It used to be the London approach.
Yeah.
The majority of firms practicing in arbitration at the moment will do their own advocacy. So don't want anyone who's keen on doing advocacy to be afraid that if you qualify here that you're not going to get to do the advocacy. There are most arbitration practices are now doing their own advocacy.
I think that's true, but I do think that the fact that, you know, you have to make a choice whether you're a solicitor or a barrister at the beginning, it kind of guides people's mind, maybe not in arbitration, but at some point, you know, of how comfortable they are in doing advocacy. And I think at the end of the day, again, it really depends who your tribunal is. Maybe you want to take a certain approach with a civilian, you know, tribunal, which you wouldn't take with someone who's from Texas or, you know, U.S. qualified, I wouldn't argue the case the same way.
I agree that there's styles, and everyone has a different style. And some styles are going to be natural to you, and sometimes you have to put one on because you know that your audience, the tribunal, needs something from you that you're not. In my case, they typically don't need someone who's obnoxious and from Philadelphia to get up and do some lame, you know, a few good men imitation. But what I'll say is that there's effective and there's ineffective, and in one particular instance to say that some styles are bad. Some styles are antiquated and sort of overly verbose and unnecessary, and, you know, for instance, I will always be amused by a advocate telling the tribunal that they submit something. Well, no shit, that's why you're standing there. Who else is submitting it? Why engage in all of this extra verbiage? And you can't tell me that there's a single tribunal there that won't find you excluding those words to be just as effective as if you put that verbal crutch in there. It's true. I mean, why do we talk when we're advocating in a different way than we talk when we're trying to convince, you know, a family member or a friend to do something? I mean, obviously, we don't drop the F-bomb as much as I typically do, but you will go into it, and you don't need to say, well, you know, sirs, I submit to you. Why? Does that make what you're saying better? Does it add any substance? Absolutely not. And where I've seen it the most is you get advocates, particularly senior advocates in India, who are engaged in this rigid formality. And you sit there, and I sat as a secretariat on a tribunal once where there was a really senior advocate, and it took 10 minutes just to get to the point because there was so much throat clearing. So whilst I completely agree that there's, you have to tailor your style to the audience, there's ineffective and there's effective.
I had a couple of points just to what Ania said in defense of London practices. At my firm at King & Spalding, we do all of our own arbitration advocacy, but also all of our own court advocacy in-house. We don't go to the independent bar unless it's a really niche area. And we've 3 QCs in-house and several court advocates in-house. So don't be discouraged about London. The split profession, its role is decreasing, say to the extent that you want to be a barrister for some reason. But I was going to tell an anecdote, which was I participated in a discussion along these lines a couple of years back at the ASA below 40. So the ASA is the Swiss Arbitration Association, and it was all around differences between civil and common law approaches in advocacy. And I wish I had the slide with me today, because it was a piece of transcript from a hearing that I'd participated in. Swiss chair of the tribunal, Pierre Carrar, who's quite well known. And there was an English barrister, pretty old school, on the other side, cross-examining a witness who was, I can't remember exactly where he was from, but he was quite hot-headed. And the English barrister on the other side kept saying, I put it to you, sir, that you didn't do that. I put it to you that you were there. I put it to you that even though this document says this, you were doing that. And the guy kept exploding because he was essentially being accused of lying. And then you've got this wonderful piece of transcript where Pierre Carrar, as the chair of the tribunal, very, very wearily says, I've got to explain to you that he's just doing his job as he understands it to be. There's this rule in England where if you want to tell the tribunal that somebody has lied, you have to actually say it to them in cross-examination, in all fairness to them, before you can then make the submission that they were a liar. And what I found really interesting, and I don't know whether you would agree with this, there was a DC practitioner there whose name currently escapes me, who said, good God, in the US, if we want to say somebody lied when they were being cross-examined, we won't say it to them during the cross-examination, we'll say it afterwards. But there is this archaic rule, and it's still applicable in English court proceedings, that if you want to, you know, impugn somebody for what they're saying or really contradict them in your submissions later on, you have to have given them the opportunity. You have to say, I put it to you that when you say that right there, it's not the truth. For what it's worth, that's the anecdote.
Yeah, I mean, I think what that takes us to is, I think we're starting to see it's been emerging for the last few years, we're starting to see emerging an international culture of arbitration. And there are some people who are very much a product of their local school of advocacy, but there also are people all around the world who've learned from international practitioners, who've done arbitration for a long time, who themselves are taking an international approach. And that approach is very similar whether you are in London, in Paris, or New York, and it does exist. But you're right, I mean, everyone is right. You still have people who are a bit outsiders, who are not as familiar with the system, and if they have been trained as barristers, then they will argue before an international tribunal as if they were before a UK court. Mm-hmm. And that's not effective, or not as effective.
Unless your tribunal is...
Yeah. Unless a tribunal is made up of retired judges or QCs.
No, but even then, they're not going to find it more effective because you're going engaging in that kind of...
I think judges, if they've learned... if they come from a UK background and they have the UK approach and it's their first time sitting as arbitrator, they will expect to skeleton arguments, they will expect very much to follow the UK approach. Very recently, I had some fun anecdote, actually. We had an international tribunal, so the chair was Laurent Lévy, so a very famous Swiss arbitrator. The co-chair was Rusty Park, very famous American arbitrator. And the other co-chair was a very well-known English QC. And the other side made some interesting arguments, and one of the things they did at some point is they put up a slide on the screen which, with the words of the contract, as they should be written if we were going to win the case. And then the QC, when he saw that, jumped out of his seat and said, that's not acceptable. And it turns out, in arbitration, that's very acceptable. So he ended up just saying, steer clear of the English courts. And he had been appointed by that party who used the slide. And that's when actually the party responded, well, believe me, sir, I will stay well clear of them. But there you go. Yes, we all have different approaches where we start from. But I think at some point they blend in, and there really is an international arbitration way of doing things, and you have to adapt to your audience.
And I think you see it. I don't know if any of you had Sir Gordon Langley as an arbitrator. He was a former English Commercial Court judge. When he first left the bench and became an arbitrator, he was very, very English court in his approach and very interventionist, would butcher advocates, asking them loads and loads of questions, exactly as he had been on the bench. And now, I don't know how many years it's been, 6-7 years, and we, as a firm, having not nominated him, he was the wing for the other side, we've had him a couple of times, and he's very much changed and adapted to the culture, to the extent that you look at him now and you think he's a genuine internationalist. And so you see the process having its influence on people who you think might be really quite set in their ways.
Mm. Okay, any more questions before we go on to our last topic? No? Okay, over to you, Ruth.
Okay, so it falls to me to talk about the intersection between courts and arbitration and the extent to which there's a common and civil law clash there. And I know I'm allotted 5 minutes and we're getting close to the drink, so I shall be mercifully quick. I wanted to talk about two points of intersection and two really quite short points. So the point of intersection during or prior to the arbitration where you may need court support, and then the point of intersection during enforcement, so when you want to enforce your arbitral award. And in relation to during or prior to the arbitration, I was going to rely upon an anecdote. And I must say, to start off with, I am a pure common law lawyer. I am an English lawyer by background. I do a mix of commercial arbitration and English court work, lots of English court work in support of arbitration. So to the extent I make observations on civil law jurisdictions, one of you is from there and I'm utterly wrong, jump up and down and shout. But in any event, a couple of years back, I had a case which was London-seated, Italian governing law substantively. And so we had Italian co-counsel. The parties were in various different places, and it was all about the supply of luxury goods, which seemed initially very exciting, but then got old quite quickly, unfortunately. And essentially, the other side was threatening to withhold supply of these luxury goods with the potentially devastating effects for our client. And we looked at getting an interim injunction, and we thought about some kind of pre-arbitral emergency relief. We thought about the Milan courts and we thought about the English courts. And there's a tendency when people are talking about injunctive relief and common law versus civil law, and certainly in Europe, when you look at England, we're almost like the black sheep. We have these extraordinary powers, anti-suit injunctions, worldwide freezing injunctions, that courts in other jurisdictions around Europe think are exorbitant, think they go too far. But really, in that case, I started to see the limitations of our system in the English courts, because we analysed side by side, should we try and get a pre-arbitration injunction mandatorily to prevent these guys from cutting off the chain of supply? Should we go in Milan? Should we go in London? And I don't know if any of you have practised English litigation or studied English litigation, but just to give you the run of it, if you're going to try and get an injunction prior to an arbitration for something of this kind, you're going to apply ex parte, which means you are going to have to comply with a duty of full and frank disclosure, which means you will file both a witness statement and a skeleton argument in which not only do you make all of the arguments in favour of your case, but you have to dream up every conceivable argument that the other side would make if they were there and disclose those arguments. And that's an onerous obligation. There's a decision, Bora and Djibouti, of Mr. Justice Flo in the commercial court, and I don't normally recommend reading, and it's a very interesting piece of reading, and it's a salutary tale to lawyers, but it's an instance where someone was found in breach of his duty of full and frank disclosure, and it really is sobering reading. So that's an exorbitant obligation. In addition to that, if you're going to get an injunction in the English courts, your client is usually going to have to give a cross undertaking in damages, which basically means if it turns out at the far end of the case that the injunction was wrongly granted, there needs to be a pot of money set aside in court to cover the damages of the other side that they may have suffered. And then an additional point is that in getting an injunction in England, you will have one hearing ex parte to get the injunction. You will then get a return date, by which point the other side knows about the injunction, and there's an inter-parties hearing where you have a further fight about it all. And the cost of these things can vary wildly, but suffice it to say that it is significant. And our counterparts in Milan said, well, if we want to get an injunction, our biggest problem is it's August in Milan and most people are away, but we'll have to file a written submission, and then we might be seen in camera by a judge for half an hour, and then hopefully we'll get the injunction, and we think it will cost this, which, suffice it to say, was a fraction of what we had looked at. And I don't want to do myself out of business here in London, but it was understandably much more attractive to the client. And sure enough, the submission was filed. There was a half-hour hearing before a female judge who was dragged away from her vacation in August in Milan, who basically bashed the parties' heads together and said, I'm giving this injunction and you have 2 weeks to settle this matter or else I'll give it permanently. And it was substantially more economic than its London counterpart would have been. As I say, I'm not trying to do myself out of a job, but... and what was also actually a lesson for me there, and I don't know if we have any Italians here, but the Italian courts tend to have a bad reputation insofar as supporting arbitration is concerned, but that was a glowing example of a very positive experience. So then turning to enforcement, which is the other point in time when you have a heavy degree of intersection between the courts and arbitration, and I'm going to agree with Timothy that I don't think there is a civil and common law clash here. I actually think, by and large, you see a universal approach in sophisticated jurisdictions to the enforcement of awards and to issues
like public policy, which are typically raised in defence of the enforcement of awards. And insofar as there are distinctions, I don't think they're drawn along civil and common law lines. So, for instance, there's a lot written about the treatment of decisions, of awards that have been annulled at the seat of an arbitration. And the approach there differs from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. So, for instance, in the UK and the US, if an award has been annulled at the seat of the arbitration, that judgment will typically be upheld in the courts of the UK or the US. But the same is true in the Netherlands, which is a civil law jurisdiction. Where it's not true is France, because they take the view that the arbitral award almost stands alone. So there is a distinction there, but it's not drawn along civil and common law lines. So I think it's possibly too simplistic to try and think about it in that way when it comes to enforcement.
Well, actually, particularly in that case, because the US is actually a division between various circuits in the US, because some US courts actually take the view that even if the award is not at the seat, they can still enforce it, and some disagree. So even within the English, the two big common law countries, there's a disagreement, at least internally.
Well, that's split amongst the circuits in the US. Yeah. But I agree, I think that when you get into... if there's any divergence there, it's more along the lines of kind of Western countries and then also pro-arbitration and sort of kind of arbitration agnostic jurisdictions. And I think largely about the Middle East, for instance, where enforcement of awards is not easy at all because the public policy exception to the New York Convention is read very, very broadly. Whereas if you look at, I think it's the Cromalloy decision in the US that says that public policy exception should be read incredibly narrowly, and other courts in the West have sort of taken that view. So, but even within sort of this Western milieu, you have distinctions. So I take a case I worked on, the Dalla decision, which an award that was not enforced in the Supreme Court of that is the UK. But was enforced by the Court de Cassation, I believe, in France. So, and I think there was some competition there to say, hey, we're more friendly arbitration jurisdiction. But
what's interesting in that case too, that the UK Supreme Court was applying French law in that award.
Yeah.
But remarkably, when the UK court applies French law, it looks a lot like English law.
It does, but I'll say this. What a lot of people miss about that case is if you read the award on jurisdiction from which everything flowed, it was worthless. I mean, if an associate had brought me that draft award and said, oh, this is what I think we should do on jurisdiction here, I'd probably have to have a talk with HR about whether that person should still be working at the law firm. And this is what people had to enforce. So if you look at, the High Court there and why they took the approach that they did, and then you get up to Lord Mance, and Lord Mance looks at this thing and says, well, I'll apply French law. It's easy for him to do so. And I say this as someone who was trying to enforce the award.
Okay, any questions?
No?
Well, we have 10 minutes to go, and I'm told that we can't go early because cocktails are going to be served after 6. But if just before we end, I mean, does anyone have any kind of questions about a career in arbitration, much more generally? I mean, you can ask us...
She still want one.
We'd be happy to answer kind of more general questions on arbitration, anything that you want to know. Yeah.
I find it very fascinating that you always have all these different jurisdictions and laws applicable. And I'm just wondering, how do you deal with this in practice? Do you just have like really international teams all the time, or do you just deal with it? Let's say Italian law at some point?
You almost always get local counsel to work with you if the applicable law, the substantive law is from a different jurisdiction. Now, the extent to which you use them and rely on them will differ depending on their quality, and qualities are quite disparate across the board.
You know, I've worked a lot over the past 3 years in various jurisdictions in Africa. We've had local counsel that we've basically been allowed to take a back seat to because they're really good. And then other jurisdictions that come from sort of an English colonial background where we basically need to do all the legal research, draft the legal submissions, and then send them to them and say, does this comport with the law in, say, Tanzania that broke away in 1961? And you're laughing because I think you've had similar experiences.
Yes, identical in various places.
Yeah, but again, you know, it just depends. You do have jurisdictions. We have a case against Lebanon where we can rely on local counsel to do everything. It just depends on the quality.
So,
of
I mean, orders. Local counsel, or a lot of us are in international offices, so we may well have an office based. In a jurisdiction.
I would say the same thing applies when it comes to some of these multi-jurisdictional law firms.
I mean, it is the wonderful thing about doing arbitration is that actually most, you know, you can be sat in London, but your team is likely to be a mix of lawyers from all over the world, and that is one of the best things about doing arbitration.
Yeah, if I may just add, I totally agree with everything that's been said. If you have an international law firm, it really helps, you know, to work with, you know, your local offices there. If you have also depends if you have a case that's going on for several years or a client that's been there for years. Usually what happens is you try to recruit someone who's from that jurisdiction because it helps. Even just for the language purposes, for example, you know, because at least you could check internally, you know, stuff that you don't want to delegate everything to the local lawyer. So
some law firms, especially the US law firms in London, have interns that are paid very little, but work very long hours. And so actually, let's say you have a dispute that's Spanish speaking, and you don't happen to have a Spanish speaker in your team, you could just draft in some Spanish students or newly qualified Spanish lawyers in as interns and get them to assist on the dispute. Right. So there are different ways of dealing with it.
It's a great point.
Go ahead. The other thing, and I'm wondering now if this is something that's fallen out of practice, because I haven't seen this in a long time, is you used to see international law firms or English law firms or US law firms running disputes and say the governing law was Kazakh law, and each side would have a Kazakh law expert. Mm-hmm. And I don't see that as much these days, but it's one way of dealing with it. It's not very effective, but it is one way of dealing with it.
Any other questions? Yep.
Nowadays, with the amount of technology that we have, the data...
You haven't introduced yourself, by the way.
Sorry. I'm Pedro Alvarez. I'm from UCL. I'm doing my master's degree in law. With this amount of data that we have in international arbitration, construction arbitration, we have big thousands of pages that is almost impossible to perform the old kind of research that we are used to, that read every single page, that what nowadays is impossible. How much the e-discovery trend has impacted the arbitration practice?
I can say that for the last 4 years of cases that I've done, we've had to have an e-discovery provider involved. We've had to do forensic collections of hard drives. We've had to use software that wasn't simply kind of search term and review platform, but software that used algorithms to delimit the amount of information that you had to review. I think it's pretty common now. But I think one of the things that gets taken for granted when you have the discussion about the volumes of data are out of control, disclosure is out of control, is that if you're doing it the right way, you are getting that information early, even as a claimant or respondent, and you're reviewing it first to know what your case is, to know where your weakness is, but more importantly, to know what the good documents are for you. So I do a big arbitration right now involving a petrochemical plant in Brazil. The client is Italian. It took a lot of convincing of an Italian client that's from a civil law background that they had important discovery duties that they needed to fulfill. But the real convincing point for getting them to hire an e-discovery provider was, we want to know the good documents, and we want to get those early. So we have those now, probably 6 months before any statement of claim will be coming from the other side, and we'll have reviewed it all. I just think that the focus tends to be a little bit more on expense and volume rather than an opportunity to make your best case, to know what it is, not simply be reactive to what the other side says if you're a respondent.
Yeah, I mean, if the platform you're using is good enough, you don't have to read everything to find the good stuff, which is really your point. Whereas when you had the hard copy files, which I sort of still slightly miss, because I think my eyesight is going, but you had to read everything to know whether you had something good or not, which is pretty tedious.
There's a question here.
Yes. I'm Macarena Simonovic, I'm from Chile. And my question is, where third-party funding comes in the picture? What's your experience in the relationship with him, and how's his participation?
So I think the fear is that a third-party funder is going to somehow come in and try and control the way the arbitration is conducted. And I think that's a fear that's held by people that have never actually used third-party funding, because my experience has been that they very much stay in the background. I mean, unless there's an order by the tribunal that you need to disclose the identity of the third-party funding and the terms of the funding, the third-party funder stays in the background and relies on counsel to make decisions on strategy, procedure, submissions, and so on. You tend to just copy the third-party funder in, or send them copies of documents you're sending out, or let them read it before you submit, and so on. But they don't actually interfere in how the arbitration is conducted. That's been my experience, anyway.
Wow. Some are more hands-on than others, and want more updates, and you have to have weekly calls, and they'll tell you that they don't think that you're taking the right strategy with a particular submission. The big difference that I've seen over the past, just say, year or 2 years with third-party funders is the role they play in case origination. Mm-hmm. Clients are going to them first. Mm-hmm. I mean, for years I worked on, 8 years ago I was working on third-party funded cases, and it was simply a matter of clients coming to us and then us saying, we'll go find you a funder, and we have the best relationships with funders, and then you convince the funder to take the case. Now, the funders are coming to you with cases and saying, we think that you can do a good job on this case, we'll pay you rack rates to handle it. And the other thing that you see is that recently a funder started its own law firm. So I think that's an interesting development. And I don't care to think of it normatively as good or bad, but I will say, going back to the role that a third-party funder can play in actually prosecuting cases, that it's really uncomfortable. I mean, some people, myself perhaps more than others, really don't like having someone backseat drive a case. We're doing a case right now that's covered by insurers, and we have to keep insurers abreast of every single thing we do, and it's really irritating to have someone who doesn't actually do international arbitration but does insurance law second guessing why you sent a particular letter. And you can get that with third party funders, and you sort of just have to accept it in the same way that you would accept the client second guessing everything that you do, even though ethically you're bound to the client's wishes, not the third party funders.
The other thing you're seeing now as well is firms developing portfolio relationships with third-party funders. Mm-hmm. So they enter into an arrangement with a third-party funder where they agree on a certain profile of exposure, and then the firm decides which cases it's going to take on, and some are more risky and some are less, and it has access to the funding for that portfolio, and provided it balances out across the board. And in that situation, the funder would tend less to do kind of thing you're talking about, because really the firm has done the decision making.
From the other side, because I
tend to be against parties which have third party funders quite a bit, particularly recently. And what we are afraid of is, it's not them telling us what to do, obviously. It's more that once we win, because we're going to win, and once we get our cost, because we're going to get our cost as well, The party that brought the claim will not be able to pay the costs, and the third party vendor will not pay the costs because they are not party to the arbitration.
Yeah, it's a big issue. For anyone that's interested in third-party funding, I sit on the ICA Queen Mary Task Force on third-party funding, and we're due to be publishing guidelines on third-party funding, I think, at the end of this year. So it's an interesting topic. And I think we are dead on 6 o'clock, so Lucia, will you close?
So thank you very much for this wonderful discussion, and thank you the audience for your very interesting questions. Unfortunately, we have to close now, but I'm certain that our panelists will be more than happy to answer any questions you might have at the cocktail. Lastly, I would like to thank once again ICCR for all their support. I would like to remind you also that the main hearing arbitration day takes place tomorrow and starts at 10 a.m., so you are all very welcome. For example, I know that the third party funding is going to be discussed at some point, so if you're interested in this point, make sure you come tomorrow. And now I think I can close our panel today and invite you all to the cocktail.